please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
And this income beyond 1 lakh will be at 10%. If you see the development of capital market, this is highly matured market now. In terms of development index, it is rated 37th or 38th. And it has been given, even if we ignore last 2 years, it has been given a CGR of 11.1%. So it is the yield for which they are coming to the market. It is not the tax benefit for which they are coming to the market. I simply don't feel that it is something very, very big issue. It will get factored in. It has already got factored in. There was a lot of demand. And it is the right time to make that correction so that all investments have some sort of parity.
Okay, right time for a correction in the market. That's the view there from Neeraj Gupta, the DPAM secretary. But if you can give us now, sir, a sense of what we should expect on the disinvestment calendar, especially when it comes to strategic disinvestment. We had the Minister of Civil Aviation here talking about Air India and talking about Pawan Hans, and he said that Pawan Hans would actually be the first to go through before even Air India. Can you give us some sense of what and how soon we can expect the strategic disinvestment calendar to move?
Well, first of all, I have no reason to disagree with my minister. He is absolutely having the sense because the administrative department, which is hand-holding this transaction. I can assure you all these transactions are maturing pretty fast. See, we have started a strategic divestment after a gap of 12 years. And a lot of activities have taken place, a lot of oversight by different authorities, investigations. So we had to learn from our previous experience, factor all the inputs which were there, and come out with a mechanism which is transparent, professional. So it has taken little time. But all the cases are maturing pretty fast. 7 of them have already hit the market. Many more will come. And when Civil Aviation Secretary, Minister has already committed that Pawan Hans may be the first, it may be the first. So I'm sure you will not be disappointed. But first of all, strategic disinvestment is not for raising money. It is a wider concept of management of investment where we want to create or unlock the value of our enterprises, which we are not able to do in our own hands. Mm. So we are giving it to those who are bringing in more capital, management, efficiencies, technology, and they can expand. So this is for the expansion of these enterprises, is not for realizing some value or some money from these enterprises.
Oh, it is also about monetization. Let's be clear, sir. Last year, there was a specific allocation from strategic divestment. This year, you've decided to do away with that in the budget. It's 80,000 crore rupees altogether. But it is also about monetization and revenue to the government.
Shireen, fair value realization is incidental to that. But it is not primary objective for which we are divesting.
Okay, not the primary objective for which you are divesting. Mr. Jha, if I could talk to you about expenditure, sir. And one of the concerns that's being raised by people who are looking at the budget numbers, not so much on the tax side, but on the expenditure side. And the feeling is that perhaps there is an underestimation when it comes to the expenditure, sir. Whether it is for things like healthcare, where the allocation is up by about 3-odd%, education about 3.8%, rural development about 1.4%. The feeling is that, is there perhaps an underestimation on the expenditure side?
Well, to give you a broad picture, the year-on-year growth, if you take for the budget estimates of 18-19 over the revised estimates of 17-18 is about 9%, 9.2%. I'm taking out a specific allocation of about 90,000 crores, which is the transfer to the states for the GST compensation cess.
Right.
So that is basically a neutral entry because it is adjusted against receipts, which will be there on that cess. So year on year is 9.2. It is consistent with the year on year growth over the last few years, where the next year's budget is. Now, the important thing to note is that if you see the budget estimates of health, for instance, of this year, and the provisions for next year, it's grown by almost 11.5 to 12%. The reason you are comparing with the revised estimates and coming to a smaller number is because the revised estimates contains a specific provision of almost 3,500 crores, which is a one-off adjustment of an external aided project for immunization,
okay,
which was due to come this year and which has to be adjusted in this year's budget. So if I take the budget estimates of this year and the budget estimates of next year, year-on-year growth is about 11.5%. Rural development, if I count in the investment which I am bringing from outside for Prime Minister's Awas Yojana, amounting to almost 12,000 crores, which is also listed in the annex to the budget speech of the finance minister.
Yeah.
The year-on-year growth will be much more than the nominal GDP growth for rural development. Mm. Education, there is a transformative change in the approach of the government this year because we are trying to fund the capital expenditure through extra budgetary resources for which an agency called HEFA, Higher Education Funding Agency, has been created. It will mobilize funds from the private sector. Public-private partnerships can be entered into. Funds can be raised by pooling resources of different IITs, IIMs, NITs, and raising money at a much cheaper rate from the bond market or from the financial institutions. So if I add that to the education budget, it again goes up by more than 12%. So all in all, I don't think there is an under-provisioning of any kind in the estimates of next year.
Okay, let me then rephrase my question. There is perhaps an over-reliance on the EBR, sir, because you just gave us an example of education and how you're hoping to rely on the extra budgetary resources. Can you give us some light? Because a lot of the social sector spending, social sector expenditure is now reliant on the EBR, sir.
Well, I'll take the example of education. Now, we fund IITs, NITs, IIMs, which are required. More IITs, newer IITs are coming. On an average, an IIT costs 1,200 crores to become fully operational. I can't provide all the money in 2 to 3 years' time that is required for one IIT to come in. So where do I get the money? Now, a lot of my older IITs require money for upgradation of their infrastructure, for adding assets, for adding equipment. They are in a position to repay because they earn a lot of money through other sources. Now, if they can repay and I raise money from the market and lend it out to the IITs and they take the burden of repayment of interest and principals, I don't think anything wrong is there.
Okay.
Because that money which I'll save from investment in the older IITs, I can fund the new IITs with that. So that's the way expenditure.
So can you give us some sense of, for instance, just for the education sector, because that's what you're talking about, what is the kind of expectation that you have on account of the extra budgetary resources, sir?
See, what we have done is that we have provided about 500 crores to the agency in the current year, and we are adding 2,700 crores, 2,750 if I remember correctly, to the agency for the next year. They have a tie-up with Canara Bank and they are going to mobilize funds and we are expecting something like 22,000 crores to be raised by this agency for funding of different educational institutions.
Okay.
And we also propose to add, for your information, even new All India Institutes of Medical Sciences.
Yes.
Or some of the medical colleges in some places which can possibly generate some additional resources to take care of the repayment of principal or interest.
Sir, since this was spoken of as a farm-first budget, let me ask you, and you know, I had Yogendra Yadav of Swaraj Abhiyan on my program, so I'm going to ask you to do a double count or a double check of the numbers that he gave me. But they've put together a mark sheet of what the budget has been able to deliver on the agriculture front, and I'm reading out from that. The disaster relief allocation, there's been a marginal decline over the previous year's allocation. PMKSY, the increase is just about 600 crore rupees. The market intervention and price support scheme has fallen from 950 crores to 200 crores. The budgetary outlay for the for agriculture is a mere 2.3% of the total budget, according to all the math that they've been able to put together from the budget. Would that be accurate?
Well, let me take it one by one. The first one was the
disaster relief allocation.
Disaster relief, yes. Now, disaster relief, we provide money through an arrangement called the National Disaster Relief Fund, which is to be funded out of a CESS.
Okay.
Which is called the National Disaster Relief Funding CESS. You know, it was, and our collections used to be to the tune of about 9,000 to 10,000 crores, which was put back into this NDRF, which is a rotational fund in the sense that whatever is saved in a current year gets added to the fund for the next year. But this year, because of GST, the CESS is gone.
Yeah.
The NCEF, if that's what I remember. Yeah, NCEF, that has gone. Now, so what we are doing is that we are funding it out of our budgetary resources. The demands on disaster relief has been a little less this year as compared to the previous year, largely because we have not had many major disasters, either major floods or droughts at the of the scale which we had in the past. We have some demands which we will meet out of this money which is available to us. Next year, we have put 10,000 crores. So there's no real reduction. And these are demand driven. If if there is a disaster and we feel the need to provide more money, we'll provide more money.
So the overall budgetary outlay,
PMKSY has actually gone up. I don't
by
know
about
from 600, where he is.
600 crores. No, no, he says it's gone up.
Crores,
he's saying it's only 600 crores.
No, it's only 600 crores. But again, PMSKY, you should also, Krishi Sichai Yojana has a very large component of AIBP, which is funded through a fund called LTIF, you know, long-term irrigation fund.
Yeah.
So when you add that, which is being funded by NABARD and routed through the states, again, it adds up to a much larger number.
Is the budgetary outlay for agriculture only 2.3% of the total budget, sir?
Of the?
Of the budget?
Yeah, perhaps it is. It's around 2.3% of the budget. But then there are other interventions which you should count in, which are fairly significant. You should also count in the animal husbandry and
as well
the
as the aquaculture
sector. You should count in the expenditure which we make on agriculture research.
Okay.
The expenditure on agriculture research has gone up dramatically by 1,000 crores.
Okay.
So you should add that also to it.
Okay.
You should add the budget of the food processing ministry,
which
also
is doubled. The allocation
for
food processing
for
is doubled from 7,000 crores to 14,000 crores.
You have to look at it.
You
can't pick out a scheme and say that you have underprovided.
Fair enough. So animal husbandry is about 5.4% of the total budget, and food processing, as you pointed out, goes from 7,000 crores to 14,000 crores.
And the extra budgetary resources which we have flagged in the budget speech of the finance minister.
Okay. All right. So I'll come back to you, Mr. Jha, with more questions on the expenditure side. But Ms. Abhishek, let me ask you, sir, the startup ecosystem is awfully disappointed. Lots of people tweeting us saying that the budget has failed them. It has done nothing about the angel tax. It has not clarified on the issue that they're facing when it comes to fair value, etc. How do you respond?
If you see the budget speech of the finance minister,
it's a promise. It's only a promise.
First of all, see, earlier the tax benefits given to startups in 16-17 from 3 out of 7 years. These were given to startups which are incorporated between April 16 and March 19. Now, this has been extended from April 16 to now March 2021.
Okay.
So, this tax benefit has been extended by 2 more years. So that's important. Secondly, under the Finance Act, the definition of startup which are eligible for tax benefits has been now aligned with the definition given by DIPP, which is that now we have given a much broader definition of startups, which can create wealth or which can generate jobs and so on, which is a very wide definition.
Okay.
So I think these are two specific interventions made for startups. So far as the angel tax is concerned, as you would know, any investment coming from the angel funds or as AIF are not counted as income for the startups investing company under Section 56 of the law. Now, this provision has been there, and it is also known to people who invest in startups that any investment made above fair market value will be counted
but
as income
question,
under Section 5.
But the question there, sir, is on the issue of fair market value, the problem is that income tax notices or tax notices are being sent out to people because the tax department is saying that we don't understand how you've been able to arrive at this value.
See, the mechanism that has been worked out from April 16 onwards is that there is an inter-ministerial committee if they certify a startup, then this income is not counted as towards tax for the startup. What we have proposed now, and we are getting it ratified by the Department of Revenue, we will soon entrust this work to an interministerial committee. But and such startups who receive any angel funding from April 16 onwards will be eligible for being covered, exempted under Section 56.
Okay.
It will not be counted as income for them. But important. But this is only for investment from April 16 onwards.
Yeah. Okay. Well, there's still a lot of disappointment on that front, sir. So you will probably hear a lot more of those queries coming your way. But Mr. Gupta, let me come back to you now, sir. In terms of what the plan is on the disinvestment side, I mean, ETF is something that you bet on in a big way in the year that closes in March. What's going to be the focus? What's going to be the priority for you in this year, sir?
First of all, when you mentioned about ETF, I forgot to share with all of you. In the finance bill, there is a provision of fund of fund, which is designated, which is being invested in a designated ETF. Earlier, the treatment for this fund of fund investment was of debt. The finance bill suggests that it will be treated as equity now. So any fund of fund which is designated to invest in an equity ETF will be having a treatment in the hands of investors, and how it will benefit, and how it will benefit me also. Nearly 6 crore active folio holders in the mutual funds, they have to go through mutual fund route. And they don't have access to ETFs directly because they don't have a DMAT account, or nearly 1 crore active DMAT accounts are there. Now, with that type of provision, a market maker can definitely access, and the level and expense ratios of the ETFs is very, very low, less than 1 basis point. So over and above that, a reasonable charge. So at very small expense ratio, 6 crore folio holders will have access, retail folio holders will have access to ETF market for the first time. So this is one. ETF will be a route of divestment and will bring more funds to ETFs.
Great. We've got a question here. Mr. Kanabar, go ahead.
My question is for Mr. Abhishek. We discuss about startups, and I really welcome the changes which have been made. I think the pushing forward of the date was something which was really very welcome. But the premise with which we began to say that if somebody has received money which is beyond the market value, therefore constitutes income, is really recharacterizing what is otherwise a capital receipt into an income. And the issue which arises at a practical level, when, as Shirino was mentioning earlier, we see several notices being issued to startups questioning the basis of valuation. And that creates a day-to-day practical difficulty. We are talking not about funds which are sort of not known. These are talking of globally recognized funds making investments in legitimate startup. And really to put those valuations in a way in which Section 56 requires is really putting undue hardship out there, sir.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
So, as I mentioned earlier, if any investment is made into any of these risky business models or risky companies through the AIFs, which are registered by SEBI, obviously they are exempted. Their investment is not counted as income under Section 56. Now, the question is that many of these angel investor groups, they don't operate through the angel fund route of SEBI regulation. They operate directly and invest directly as individuals. Now, after the Startup India program was announced in January 2016 by the Honorable Prime Minister, the income tax law has been amended, and certified startups are now eligible for their investment not being counted as income. There is a mechanism, as I explained. So this benefit is available from any investment made from April 2016 onwards.
Okay, here's a question here coming in, sir.
First of all, I'd like to thank the representatives here on presenting a budget which has quite a few landmark items. My question is, few years back, we heard from the government on the Make in India initiative. There's a common perception that the Make in India initiative has remained largely an initiative. There's been a lot of buzz around it, but hasn't really been successful in spurring the manufacturing activity in the country. What is the current thinking, and how do you propose to take that forward?
See, the Make in India program was meant to promote manufacturing, as you mentioned, to increase the share of manufacturing in our GDP, take it from 16-17% to 25%. But the important thing is that when you manufacture, you have to be competitive. And you look at the costs. Our logistics costs are so high. They're 14% of GDP, whereas it is 7% in China. The government has been making huge investments in public infrastructure, which is going to gradually reduce this cost of logistics, and GST itself is going to be a big help, or is already helping. Now, skilling of manpower. We need to skill 500 million people. The industry doesn't have the kind of skilled manpower that they require. And you look at the ease of doing business. Ease of doing business was not even a topic 3.5 years back. Today, you see the amount of work that has been done, but there is so much more work to do. And tax policies. You look at the kind of support that is required. We had a huge problem of inverted duty structure. So all these problems have to be addressed at the same time to make our industry competitive. If you can't compete, then why do you manufacture? So you only can manufacture when you can compete. So to improve your competitiveness is not something that you can do in 1 day, 1 year, or 2 years. It is a medium and long-term process. Just by announcing Make in India, one should not think that everything will be made in India. But then how do you sell them? You have to compete. So I think what the government is doing on a very focused program of improving our competitiveness through all these series of interventions,
okay.
The tax policies, fiscal policies, infrastructure, skilled manpower, and standards. We have very few technical regulations in our country. We have just 150, and we have 1,500 in the European Union. This has been a largely neglected subject. In the last 6 months, so many new technical regulations have come to give level playing field to our industry.
Right.
So I think you have to look at it in that perspective.
Okay. Mr. Jha, let me ask you, sir, in terms of the public enterprises spend, sir, the spend target has gone up quite substantially from about 3.85 lakh crores to 4.78 lakh crores, sir. That's a 93,000 crore rupee jump in terms of what you expect spending from public sector enterprises, sir. So this is going to be one of the key pillars as far as the government strategy is concerned?
That's right. Because if you see the numbers, you will find that bulk of this will come from the railways and from the road sector. Because the railways, the extra budgetary resources are going up by almost 25,000 crores. About 20,000 crores over the current year, and in the case of roads also, it's going up. So a lot of this funding will come from the railways and the road sector. Apart from this, the other public sector undertakings also take up investments, and all that has been factored in. And we expect that the resources that we will mobilize from the market and from through the internal resources of public enterprises, etc., will add up to almost a lakh of crores more than this year.
Okay, so big reliance there on PSC spending. Mr. Gupta, there's a question for you here, sir.
Mr. Gupta, first of all, my compliment on exceeding your target this year. You've done very well from 80,000 to almost 100,000 crores. Keeping that in mind, and given where the market conditions are except today, do you think your 80,000 crores of target for the next year could have been slightly better and more?
High expectations from you, Mr. Gupta.
Well, if we see the... First of all, thank you. We definitely have done more than 72,500, which was the target for this year. We have clocked 92,500 till today. Now, if you see, the expectation should be from the budget. So the budget team definitely takes care of all the resources which they need and whatever the possible methods of raising them. Disinvestment or investment management is one of them. So expectation of 80,000 is pretty big expectation, and definitely the department's endeavor will be to meet it. But if you see 5 years back, or 3 years back, last year and this year if you leave, our average realization used to be 20,500 crores. So from that we are almost four times expectation. But nonetheless, if the budgetary requirements are there, all endeavors will be made. And it is not an exercise of selling the equity only today. It is multi-pronged approach which we have seen now. So while managing our investment, we are incidentally having a lot of receipts also.
Okay, sir, if I may ask you a quick question on the strategic disinvestment pipeline. Cabinet approval has been given to the list that was approved by Niti Aayog, and I know a lot of these are relatively smaller companies, but when can we expect, whether it's the expression of interest to move forward, the bidders to be announced? I mean, give us some sense of the calendar on the strategic disinvestment, sir.
I think we just touched that question.
No, the only answer we got was Pawan answer. We didn't get anything more concrete.
I can first of all assure you that most of the deals are on track. They are progressing and in very advanced stages. You can definitely see them getting concluded. You have not watched closely because four of the hotels have already parted way from the government undertakings. Two more are entering the market for joint leasing. Seven of the deals are already in expression of interest stage. Even if you call strategic divestment, even HPCL sale has to go through the whole process of strategic divestment. Mm. It has to be a very professionally done, market validated deal. And this is what I can say with a lot of confidence, it was done like this. It's also a strategic divestment. But when you talk about the big ones, I don't know what is the meaning of a big one. So big one is generally what attracts your imagination and which is Air India. Definitely you will see light of the day.
Okay, we've got a question here.
So my question is in continuation of our discussion on startups and the AIFs and VCFs investment in the startups. The question is, I think there was a mention in the speech with regard to the overhaul or streamlining or rationalizing further the tax and regulatory regime for the alternative investment funds and venture capital funds. I think lots have been done in past. We must compliment the government for that in terms of the regulatory regime as well as tax regime for the AIFs and the VCFs. What more is to be done? Can you give some indication on that?
See, in November, I had a meeting with Chairman SEBI and his officials, along with all the angel investor networks in the country. And they formed a committee to streamline the AIF regulation relating to angel funds. They have made their recommendations. So many of those streamlining will be done by SEBI after they have examined the recommendations. But you know, we are interacting with the startups all the time to find out their regulatory issues. In last 2 years or so, we have been able to address more than 20 regulatory issues of the startups relating to the Companies Act, SEBI's regulations, RBI's regulations, and so on. Mm. It's a continuous process. There is still a lot to do. A lot of regulatory improvements are to be done by the states. And by starting a ranking of states in their support to startups and otherwise, we are now able to sensitize the states much more on improving the regulatory environment for them. So it's a complete work in progress, and as the finance minister has announced, we will continue to engage and improve the atmosphere and environment for startups from the AIF and angel investor angle also.
Mr. Jha, and then I'll hand it to you, Anil, for the final questions. Mr. Jha, a quick question, sir. You know, Mr. Amitabh Kant seemed to suggest that while 2,000 crores has been allocated for the new healthcare scheme announced in the budget, it could take about 11,000 to 12,000 crores, and that resource will be mobilized by way of the education and health cess. And at this point in time, the thinking is that that could perhaps be enough to fund that particular scheme. Is that something that A, you concur with? And B, what is the estimation of what the impact could be because of the MSP change, sir?
On the health side, I at this time may not be able to give you a number because it depends a lot on the contours of the program that will unfold. And,
but they must have given you some number, sir, while you were putting the budget together.
No. We have a broad outline of the program. We have a broad sense of what is to be achieved and how it will be implemented. The challenge is to implement this program in such a way that the leakages can be prevented. It will also take some time, in the sense 2 to 3 months, 4 months, maybe 5 months for it to actually come on ground and become, and for the states to start implementing the program. Because a number of states already have that system of providing insurance in some form or the other. The RSBY framework is also there. So we have a sense of idea about the way it will unfold, but then the nitty-gritty has to be worked out. It would certainly be much more than the 2,000 crores which has been provided. And as I mentioned yesterday also in the discussions we had with you on your channel, that this is a number to start the program and to show the commitment of the government. And as and when the program unfolds, extra funds will be provided.
No, because the reason I ask you this is because all kinds of numbers are doing the rounds. You know, someone is saying it'll cost 25,000 crores.
Well,
someone is saying it'll cost 100,000 crores.
See, let me tell you, in the RSBY setups are in the range of 3.5 to 4.2 crores roughly over the years. It has varied actually across states, and a cover of 30,000 was given.
Yeah.
The annual spend was around 500 to 600 crores of the Government of India share.
Right.
Because a part of it was state share also. But then program was had certain limitations. And
significantly lower. I mean, this is 30,000.
Yeah, it was lower, but then the risk spread was also much lower than what will take place under this program. So we are hopeful that we will be able to work out the details of the scheme, and in taking into account the contributions of the state as and when it is decided, the Government of India will be able to bear that additional burden from its own resources. As far as the agriculture MSP is concerned, there are two parts to the announcement. The first part is the commitment of the government to buy it at 1.5 times the cost of cultivation. And the second part is to find out the mechanism of reimbursing the difference between the market price and the MSP in case the market price is lower than the MSP.
Yeah.
So that mechanism, Niti Aayog has been mandated to do that along with in consultation with the state governments and the Ministry of Agriculture and other concerned agencies, it's because we have several models of this type of intervention which
exists. But any broad outlay, sir?
See, we have a Bhavantar scheme of Madhya Pradesh. We have our own price stabilization mechanism, market intervention scheme, which the Ministry of Agriculture runs. There's another model in some state governments where they are giving upfront input subsidy to the farmers. So there are different models. Niti Aayog, I'm sure, will be able to work out the broad contours of the program, and we'll see how it unfolds.
Okay. Final question, Anil.
Mr. Abhishek, this question is for you. In Davos, the Prime Minister made out a strong case against protectionism, and he was applauded by everybody. But in this budget, we see a raft of commodities, the customs tariffs have been increased in a clear protectionist move. How do we marry these two statements?
See, whatever has been done or is within the parameters or flexibility given by our multilateral agreements under WTO. So whenever you are talking about free trade, open trade, it is within the contours of a multilateral agreement. The agreement also provides flexibilities. If there are, let's say, there are some unfair trade practices, you can also take remedial measures. You can also impose these duties within the bound duties that you have. So this is all part of the agreement. And I think protecting our industry is absolutely legitimate. Every country does it. And it is being done within those contours of the WTO agreement.
So hike in customs duty, part of making India, not protection, but protecting our own domestic interests. On that note, gentlemen, thank you very much, Mr. Gupta, Mr. Jha, and Mr. Abhishek. Thank you for joining us here on the budget verdict. Ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause for the three gentlemen. And it gives me great pleasure now to invite on stage our budget makers. Joining us here on the CNBC TV18 budget verdict, the Finance Secretary, Mr. Hasmukh Gadia, and the DEA Secretary, Mr. Subhash Garg. Gentlemen, can we please have you up on stage, sir? Big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.